Well, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand so that it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. What did Jesus mean when he uttered those words in Matthew chapter 5? I think part of what he meant is, I want those who are followers of mine to live salty lives, lives that make people thirst for God. I want them to live lives that are like light, that shine his compassion and love and grace and forgiveness and message of hope into lives of despair. And the question I want to ask this afternoon is, how do we do that in the 21st century? What does that look like today? The theme of this conference is celebrate your faith. And I can't think of a better way for us to celebrate our faith than to give it away. But how do we do that today? I just wrote a book with a friend of mine, and we gave it a very intentional title. We called it The Unexpected Adventure. Because we are convinced that when you live on the evangelistic edge, when you're praying and seeking those opportunities for God to use you to share his message of hope, then you never know what's going to happen. It could start out an average and routine day. But if you're motivated to talk to others about Jesus, if you make yourself available, if you're prepared, you never know what's going to happen. You never know. Now, sometimes it doesn't unfold like you think it's going to unfold. And I've had my share of embarrassing instances. I had one humiliating thing happen down here in the South not too long ago, a few years ago. I was down there with Mark Middleberg, and we'd spoken at a conference, and we went to a Cracker Barrel to get some breakfast before we flew home. And we noticed they have rocking chairs on the front porch where people can people watch, right? And sitting in the first rocking chair was a young woman, about 18 years old, dark hair, dark eyes, young man sitting next to her about the same age. So we got to walk in front of them to get to the door. Well, no big deal, right? So we're walking toward the door, and just as I step in front of this young woman, I hear her say, "What's a deist?" And I thought, I just wrote a book about that. So I turned on my heels, and I looked her in the eye, and I said, "Young lady, a deist is someone who believes that God created the universe," but then he walked away. I said, "A deist is someone who believes that God sort of wound up the universe like a giant clock and is just letting it tick down." I said, "A deist is someone who believes that God is distant and detached and disinterested in us." But I said, "That's not what the evidence shows." And I began to talk about the evidence. It shows God's involvement in the cosmos. And I start showering with all this facts, all this evidence, all this data. I start talking about cosmology and physics and biochemistry and genetics and all the evidence of God's involvement in creation. And her eyes are getting bigger and bigger. And you can't stop me now. I'm on a roll. And I start talking about Jesus entering into human history. I talk about the incarnation, his miracles. I talked about his death on the cross. I talk about the evidence that he rose from the dead. And her eyes are getting bigger and bigger and bigger. I'm going on and on and on. I'm getting all animated. And finally, I turned to my friend. I said, "Can you believe it? I happened to walk in front of her." She said, "What's a deist?" My friend said, "Lee." She said, "Buenos dias." You know, I really wish that were a joke. That is exactly what happened. But you know what the good news was? The ice was already broken. How do you not get into a spiritual conversation at that point? Turned out she was there with her boyfriend for the state track meet. And so they brought us back to the hotel room where the coach was there and all the athletes, and we got to talk about Jesus for about 45 minutes. So you never know. You never know. That's the unexpected adventure. It's when you live on the evangelistic edge, it raises every aspect of your Christian life. Your prayer life takes on a whole new dimension because you're praying for your friends who don't know Christ. Your worship takes on a whole new dimension because you're worshiping the God of the second chance who lost your loved friends more than you do. It's when your Bible study takes on a whole new dimension, because you're not just looking for abstract theological truths. You're looking for something that might help you reach your friend. It's when our dependence on God is at its greatest, because we know that apart from the work of the Holy Spirit, there's nothing we can do in and of ourselves to bring about anybody's conversion. But this just lifts all aspects of the Christian life. And so how do we live on this evangelistic edge in the 21st century? Well, based on a conversation I had with a friend, I began to ask myself this question. What if Jesus literally, physically lived in my house? Physically lived there? What would I learn from the master in terms of what he would do to reach out to lost people in the neighborhood? And so as I studied the life of Jesus, I learned so much about what I think he would do today. So I want to focus on three things that I learned that I think would be something we could apply in our lives. The first one is this. Before talking to his neighbor about his heavenly father, Jesus would talk to his heavenly father about his neighbor. Right? He'd pray, wouldn't he? Of course. Before Jesus embarked on anything of significance, he brought it to the Father in prayer. In fact, have you thought about the fact that Jesus' prayers for spiritually lost people continued right up until his final gasps on the cross? John Stott, famous, as you know, British pastor, he pointed out that, you know, in the Greek, when you read the New Testament in the Greek, the imperfect tense of the Greek suggests that Jesus did not just say it once, but he kept repeating it over and over, all through the torture of the crucifixion, as the nails were being driven through his wrists, as the nails were being driven through his feet. He kept praying, he kept repeating, Father, forgive them, Father, forgive them, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they do. Jesus' prayers for people so spiritually depraved they were torturing to death the Son of God continued right up until his final gasps on the cross. And in light of that, how can we not pray consistently and specifically and fervently for lost people in our lives? I tell you, I was reading a book the other day, and it had a question in it, and I don't know if you'll find this convicting. I found it convicting. And the question is this. If God, Jesus Christ, if he were to appear physically to you this evening and say to you, I am going to answer every prayer that you prayed last week, would there be anybody new in the kingdom of God today? Wow. I mean, that's convicting, isn't it? Now, I know theologically, you know, our prayers can't force a person to receive Christ. And yet I'm just naive enough to believe James when he said the prayers of righteous people make a difference. And when we pray for people that God would open their eyes to their need for a Savior, when we pray and we say, God, open up an opportunity for me to be able to engage in a spiritual conversation with this person. I think God hears those prayers. I think he responds. I've seen it happen over and over. I remember when I was a pastor, a teaching pastor at Willow Creek, we were baptizing. Yeah, Willow? Anybody from Willow? Yeah, cool. We were baptizing like 700 people this one Sunday. People who come to Christ, we were thrilled, and we explained the gospel, and people started coming up to the platform to be baptized. And so a woman comes up to me. She had a tag on, so I knew she was going to be a candidate for baptism. She's about 60 years old. She comes up, and there was a man with her. We told him you could bring somebody up with you if you want, with you. And so a man was with her. He didn't have a tag on. And he was a tough-looking bird, about 65 years old, kind of leathery and, you know, construction worker type. You know, he probably didn't even use a hammer, just a fist, a nail. You know, you could tell, just a tough-looking guy. So I said to the woman, I said, you're here to be baptized. She said, oh, yes, I am. I said, fantastic. Have you received Jesus as your Lord and Savior? She said, oh, yes, I have. I said, that's great. And I was just about to baptize her. And I didn't usually do this, but I felt the Holy Spirit prompting me, and I turned to the man. And I said, are you her husband? He said, well, yes, I am. I said, have you given your life to Jesus Christ? And he looked at me. And his face sort of screwed up. He scowled at me. I thought he was going to hit me or something. And he burst into tears. In front of thousands of people, he's weeping and he's sobbing. He says, no, I haven't, but I want to right now. I said, wait, time out. Can we do this? Oh, okay, great. So in front of thousands of people, this guy repents of his sin, receives forgiveness through Christ, and I baptize him and his wife together. So afterwards, I'm walking down, you know, off the platform. And another woman I didn't know comes running up to me and throws her arms around me. She's weeping and sobbing. And all she can say is, 9 years, 9 years, 9 years. I said, who are you? And what are you talking about 9 years? She said, that's my brother who you just led to the Lord and baptized. I have been praying for that man for 9 long years. And she said, for 9 years, I saw not one glimmer of interest in God, but look what God did today. And you know what my very first thought was? There was a woman who was glad she didn't stop praying in year 8. Is there someone you've stopped praying for? You used to pray for them. You love them. But you almost made the decision for them and said, this person's never going to come to faith. You didn't say that, but that's kind of the attitude. We've all done this, I think. And we just sort of stop. Is there someone you can bring into your mind that you used to pray for? A lost friend? What if we all committed and said, you know what? I'm going to pray this week for this person. And one of the things I'm going to pray is that we can connect and that God would open up an avenue for a spiritual conversation. Who knows, among all the people here, what God might do. But I think if Jesus physically lived in my house, he'd pray consistently and fervently and specifically for the lost people in the neighborhood. What else can we learn from Jesus? I think the other thing I'd learn is that Jesus would assure his neighbors that his door would always be open for questions. Do you have a doubt? Got a question? Got a concern? Come on down. Bring the Starbucks. We'll sit on the floor. We'll talk about it. I was talking about this, and many of you I know have a connection with Liberty University, right? How many have some connection? Yeah, quite a few. You probably know Gary Habermas, one of the professors there. Great guy. He and I were talking about this once, and he's written books on doubt and resurrection and everything. And he said, yeah, Lee, I think you're right. I think Jesus would sit and listen and when people have doubts and questions. He said, my favorite example of this is John the Baptist. I mean, think about this. If anybody knew the identity of Jesus being the Son of God, it was John the Baptist. He once pointed to Jesus and said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He baptized Jesus and saw the heavens open up and heard the voice of the Father saying, this is my Son in whom I'm well pleased. John the Baptist once pointed to Jesus Christ and said, I have seen and I testify that this is the Son of God. But what happens? He gets arrested. He gets thrown in prison. Question. What happens to virtually all of us when tough times come? The doubts begin to creep in, don't they? And that's what happened to John. Now he's not sure anymore. Now he's full of questions and doubts. So he gets a couple friends together. He says, look, go track Jesus down and just ask him point blank, are you the one we've been waiting for? Or are we to wait for somebody else? So his friends track Jesus down. They say, hey, Jesus, you know John. Well, you know, he got busted. And he is freaking out. And now he's not so sure about you anymore. So Jesus, would you just tell us point blank, are you the one we've been waiting for? Or are we to wait for somebody else? Now, here's the issue. How does Jesus react to this? Does he get mad? Does he get indignant? How dare John have the temerity to express a doubt? No. What Jesus tells those followers of John in Luke 7:22, go back to John and report to him what you have seen and heard. The blind receive sight. The lame walk. Those who have leprosy are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and good news is preached to the poor. In other words, go back to John and tell him about the evidence that you've seen with your own eyes that confirms to you my identity as being the Son of God. So they go back and they tell John. But here's the question. Has this little incident now poisoned John in the mind of Jesus? Has it disqualified John from any role in the kingdom of God because he dared to ask a question and express a doubt? No. In fact, it's after this incident that Jesus got up before a group and said, I tell you, among those born of women, there's no one greater than John. John the doubter. John the guy with questions. Friends, it is okay for us as Christians to have questions. It's even okay to have doubts. as long as we do what John did and we pursue answers. And it's important for us, as 1 Peter 3:15 tells us, all followers of Jesus, always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have, and do it gently and respectfully. So we need to be prepared to help our friends, our lost friends and colleagues and neighbors and so, to identify those spiritual sticking points that are holding them up in their journey toward Christ. And to help them. You know, we don't have every answer. I don't have every answer. You probably don't either. But to listen and to create a safe place where they can express their doubts. And we can say, wow, that's a good question. I have no idea how to answer it. But let's find out together. And take them on a journey to get answers. Because the good news is, we have a defensible faith. We have a faith that's got great answers. I saw this, I've seen it in my life, being an atheist who investigated the evidence and came to faith. I saw it several years ago when I have a friend who was, from my atheist days, who was the national spokesman for American Atheists Incorporated. How's that for a job? And of course, I try to share Christ with him now that I'm a Christian, and we banter back and forth. And one day he said to me, you know, Strobel, you Christians are all alike. I said, what do you mean? He said, oh, you'll give the case for Christ. You'll give the evidence for God, but you won't give the evidence then against God and just let people make up their own minds. I said, oh yeah? I said, I tell you what, you go get the smartest atheist on planet Earth and I will fly him here to our church and I'll allow him to stand on the platform and proclaim the case for atheism. But I'm gonna get a Christian. And that Christian's going to present the case for Christ and then debate your atheist and we'll just let people make up their own minds. He said, you wouldn't do that. I said, oh yeah? We shook hands on it? My very next thought, probably should have asked Bill Hybels if I should. Too late. This ball was rolling. I mean, the news media got a hold of this. The Chicago Tribune did 4 advance articles on this debate. Talk radio. Why? Because the church said, we're not afraid to have an intellectual shootout over this stuff. I started to get calls from radio stations around the country. Can we broadcast this debate live? Sure. Pretty soon we had 117 radio stations coast to coast going to broadcast this thing live. We had one radio network send commentators. It was like a prize fight. It was a jab for the Christian. I think the atheist on the ropes. I mean, it was unbelievable. The night of the debate came. Traffic was gridlocked within 2 miles of our church. We opened the doors. People ran down the aisles to get a seat. When's the last time you saw someone run into a church? We had 7,776 people live in our auditorium and hooked up by overflow, video overflow. We had coast-to-coast radio about to go on the air. I was going to be the moderator, so I'm pacing. I'm nervous backstage. And one of our elders came up to me and said, so, Lee, we are going to win this, aren't we? So the debate begins, and I chose as our representative of Christianity a man I consider to be the greatest defender of Christianity in the world today, Dr. William Lane Craig. And he gets up, and he gives the most powerful 25-minute opening summation of the evidence for the existence of God and the truth of Christianity you have ever heard. And I wanted to cheer, but I was a moderator. I had to be neutral, so thank you, Dr. Craig. And now the atheist, Professor Zindler. Good luck, buddy. So they chose their best atheist. He gets up there. He's about to open his mouth. But we didn't tell him one thing. We didn't tell him that right where he was standing, underneath the stage, was a room. And that room was filled for the entire 2.5 hours of the debate with Christians who were praying that the case for Christ would go out with all its convicting power. And the case for atheism would be recognized for the bankrupt philosophy that it is. And if you've seen the video of this debate, you know God answered that prayer. We have people vote. What's your spiritual condition as you come in? Who won the debate? What's your spiritual condition as you leave? So the first thing we did, we gathered just the ballots of the skeptics, the atheists, the agnostics, the members of other world religions, the people who say, call me anything, but don't call me a Christian. We took just their ballots, and having heard the case for Christ and the case for atheism, over 8 out of 10 said the case for Christ was by far the most compelling, and 47 people walked in as confirmed atheists, heard both sides, and walked out as followers of Jesus Christ. And you know what else? Not one person became an atheist. I'm just saying. Friends, we have an unfair advantage in the marketplace of ideas. We have truth on our side. That's a big advantage. And so, you know, is my takeaway from that, therefore, we all ought to be debating people? No. I'm not a skilled debater. You probably aren't either. That's all right. I think for most Christians, the key word is not debate. It's dialogue. It's conversations. It's relationships. It's getting to know people and creating a safe environment where they can ask their toughest questions. There was a study that just came out a couple days ago. I don't know if you saw it, from George Barna and Dave Kinneman. A new study of 18 through 29-year-olds who have left the church, trying to discern what are the top reasons that they left the church. And you know what those reasons are? One of those reasons is, here's a quote, "The church feels unfriendly toward those who doubt." Over 1 out of 4 said, "I've got intellectual problems with the faith, and that's why I'm leaving." We need to create, say, I know your counselors, you create safe places in your counseling offices for people to talk honestly and authentically. We need to create those same kind of safe places in our homes, in our neighborhoods, in our Christian schools, in our youth ministries, in our churches, in our children's ministries, where young people especially, Christians and their non-believing friends, can feel the freedom, the safety to express any doubt, any question, to know that they're not going to get snapped at, they're not going to be told to shut up, but we'll help them on a journey towards some answers. As someone once said, you know, struggling with God is not the lack of faith, that is faith. We got to let our young people know it's okay to have questions, as long as you do what John did and pursue answers. Because we have a faith that's based on reality. And there are good answers to satisfy our hearts and souls. I think if Jesus lived in my house, the door would always be open for questions. Third thing I'll mention, if Jesus physically lived in my house, is that he would be authentic in the way in which he related to his neighbors. He'd be authentic. In other words, he wouldn't just communicate the gospel, he would embody the gospel. There'd be a congruence between his beliefs and his behavior, between his character and his creed. And the question is that true of us? Because I'll guarantee you something, if your neighbors know that you're a Christian counselor, if they know that you're active in your church, I guarantee you that they are scanning your life 24/7 with their hypocrisy radar. Beep, beep. Aren't they? You know they are. Beep. They're watching you 24/7. What are they looking for? False piety, right? What are they looking for? Kind of a holier-than-thou attitude. What are they looking for? You know, someone that puts on a happy face and smiley face and pretends like everything's all right when we know it's not. What are they seeing? I got a letter a few years ago from a young nurse, 24-year-old nurse. And she just poured her heart out. And she talked about how she had been abused as a child by people who claimed to be Christians and how this poisoned her toward God. In fact, I'm going to read you what she wrote to me because I think it's powerful. She said, "The Christianity that I grew up with was so confusing to me, even as a child. People said one thing, but they did another. They appeared very spiritual in public, but in private, they were abusive. What they said and what they did didn't fit. There was such a discrepancy." So listen what happened. "I came to hate Christianity and did not want to be associated with a church." That is the power of inauthentic Christians to repel people from God. You know how if you're driving down a highway at night and somebody doesn't turn off their high beams coming up the other direction, how it makes you avert your eyes? That's not the kind of light Jesus was talking about he wanted us to be. He wanted us to be like the light that shines in the sky for a new shopping center that attracts people. Oh, I wonder what that light's about. And they come and check it out. That's the kind of light he's talking about. But so many of us glare in a way that makes people turn their head away from God. And that's what happened to Maggie. But guess what happened then? She's reading the Chicago Tribune about a debate that was coming up between a Christian and an atheist at Willow Creek Church. So she said, I'm going to go just to see the Christian humiliated. So she came. And of course, the Christian won the debate. So now she's full of questions. So she started writing me these long letters. Dear Lee, here are my first 20 reasons for not believing in God. Boom, 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 boom. So I'd write back, Dear Maggie, great questions. And I thought, this is ridiculous. So I called her up and said, Maggie, you know, one of the things our church does is we create safe places for people like you who are on a spiritual journey to meet on a regular basis in a little group with, you know, four or five others like you who are on a journey, and then two committed Christians who lead the group to ask whatever questions you have and to investigate stuff together and so they can listen to what you have to say and so forth. And she said, I want to join one of those groups. So we got her in one of these little safe groups. So here's what she wrote about that experience. And the reason I bring this up is because when Jesus said 2,000 years ago, I want you to be salt and light, sometimes if you're like me, you wonder, okay, but what are lost people in my neighborhood, in my world, what do they want from me? What are they looking for from me? How can I meet their needs? How can I help them? And Maggie expresses it so well that I want you to hear her words. She said, when I came to church and to my little group, here's the first thing she needed. I needed gentleness. I needed to be able to ask any question. I needed to have my questions taken seriously. I needed to be treated with respect and validated. But most of all, listen to this, most of all, I needed to see people whose actions match what they say. I am not looking for perfect, but I am looking for real. Integrity is the word that comes to mind. I need to hear real people talk about real life, and I need to know if God is or can be a part of real life. Does he care that I need a place to live? Does he care about the wounds that I have? Can I ever be a whole and a healthy person? Well, I've asked questions like these of the Christians who lead my little group, and I've not been laughed at or ignored or invalidated. I've not been pushed or pressured in any way. In fact, she said, I don't understand the caring that I've received. I don't understand that the leaders don't seem afraid of questions. They don't say things like, you just have to have faith, or you just need to pray more. They don't seem to be afraid to tell who they really are. They just seemed genuine. And then Maggie sent me a copy of a poem that she wrote for the Christian couple that led her little group. And from the day I first read this poem, I thought, no. This is a poem that every follower of Jesus Christ on planet Earth needs to hear. Why? Because this is the heart's cry of someone far from God, the very kind of person that Jesus is telling us to be salt and light to. So I want you to listen to these words. These are not my words. It's a 24-year-old nurse abused and poisoned against God in the church who's looking into your face as a follower of Jesus and saying these words. Do you know? I mean, do you understand that you represent Jesus to me? I mean, do you know? I mean, do you understand that when you treat me with gentleness, it raises the question in my mind, well, maybe he is gentle too. Maybe he isn't someone who laughs when I get hurt. I mean, do you know? Do you understand that when you listen to my questions and you don't laugh, that I think, well, what if Jesus is interested in me too? I mean, do you know? I mean, do you understand that when I hear you talk honestly about arguments and conflicts and scars from your past, that I think, well, maybe I am just a regular person instead of a bad, no good little girl who deserves abuse? If you care, then I think maybe he cares. And then there's this flame of hope that burns inside of me, and for a while I'm afraid to breathe because it might go out. I mean, do you know? Do you understand that your words are his words? That your face is his face to someone like me? Please, be who you say you are. Please, God, don't let this be another trick. Please, let it be real this time. Please. I mean, do you know? Do you understand that you and you and you, that you represent Jesus to me? First time I read that, I just cried. I just cried. Because you know what flooded into my mind? Not all the times I've been like Jesus to someone. What flooded into my mind is how I become a professional minister, a church staff person, a professional Christian, and how I didn't have time anymore for the neighbor that lived a 5-iron shot from my house who was headed for hell. And I said, this has got to stop. And so I called her up. I said, Maggie, wow, I just felt very convicted by that poem. Thank you. And I'm speaking this weekend at the church. I think everybody ought to hear this poem. I just want to get your permission. Is it okay if I were to read it? And she said to me, oh, Lee, haven't you heard? And my heart sunk. I thought, oh, no, oh, no. What now? What inauthentic Christian has she met now that's repelled her again from God? I said, no, Maggie, I haven't heard. What's going on? What happened? She said, no, Lee, it's a good thing. I said, what? She said, Lee, on Tuesday night, I gave my life to Jesus Christ. And I said, Maggie, oh, my gosh, that's fantastic. That's true. I said, the party's probably still going on in heaven. That's great. But you got to answer me a question. You were so far from God. You were running the other way. I need to know, what brought you across the line of faith? I'm just curious. What 5 facts convinced you that the resurrection is an actual event of history? I'm just curious. She said, it wasn't like that with me. I said, yeah. What 10 facts did you learn that convinced you the Bible really is the Word of God? She said, it wasn't like that with me. I said, well, then what? Maggie, tell me what happened. Now she's embarrassed. And she kind of shrugs over the phone. She said, well, I just met a whole bunch of people at church who were like Jesus to me. And I thought, what a lesson. What a lesson for someone like me to like to pin somebody up against a wall. You know, you don't like these 10 reasons for the resurrection, I'll give you 10 more, you know. Now, it is important to keep in mind, she did hear the evidence put to the test. She came to the debate. She heard the intellectual shootout. But what was it that God used to bring her across the line of faith? I know the couple that led her little group. Humble, simple people that love Jesus Christ and love lost people. And it was their love that God used to bring her across the line of faith. And you know what the good news of that is? We can do this. We don't have to have a PhD in theology. We can do it. We can pray for lost people. We can pray consistently and fervently and expectantly. We can do that. We can listen to them. We can hear their questions, and when we don't have an answer, say, I don't know, but gosh, let's find an answer together. We can do that. But the easiest thing of all is we don't have to pretend we're more than we are. We don't have to pretend we're smarter than we are. We don't have to pretend like we're more godly than we are. We can just be sinners saved by grace who love Jesus Christ and love people. And we're just authentic, and God will use us. And when we do those kind of things, you know what? He is going to take us on unexpected adventures that will be the greatest joy of our lives. And one, I just want to tell you one last story because it's a good example, I think, of how these adventures are so unexpected. And God's got things in mind that we cannot conceive. I was a new Christian. I was a journalist in Chicago. And it was time to go home at the end of a long day. So I'm packing up my briefcase, and I felt the Holy Spirit just kicking me in the pants. And I felt very specifically that I needed to go into the business office of the newspaper and invite my atheist friend to come to church on Easter, because Easter was coming up. So I walked over to the business office of the newspaper, and I walk in there, and I look around, and all I see is my friend behind his desk. The perfect, thank you, God. So I said, hey, how you doing? He said, I'm doing all right. I said, great. I said, you know, Easter's coming up. He said, Lee, you know I'm an atheist. I said, yeah, I know, but this is when we remember the reality of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He said, oh, he wasn't resurrected. Give me a break. I said, actually, there's a lot of good historical data that he was resurrected. And I tried to talk to him a little, and you could see he was not interested. He's all the body language is like, spare me, you know? And so I tried another tack. I said, you know, Easter is coming up, and we've got great music at our church. I know you like music. Why don't you come with my wife and I? I think you'll really enjoy the music. He said, I don't want to go to your stupid church. I said, okay then. I said, did you ever think about God? He said, no. I said, okay. I said, do you have any questions about God? He said, no. Well, now I'm getting embarrassed. I mean, I've tried everything. I tried to share the gospel there. I tried to invite him. I tried to give a little evidence. This guy was not interested. So I got embarrassed. I said, hey, well, you know where my office is. So if you ever have a question, I'm there. I'll see you later. I walked out. I'm thinking, what the heck was that all about? Why did I feel so compelled to go at that moment to invite this guy to services when he shut me down? And honestly, to this day, he's still an atheist. And for a long time, I used to wonder, was I just a link in a long, long, long chain that's eventually going to lead him to faith? I no. But then, about 2 years, a few years after this, by then I was a pastor at Willow Creek Church. And I was preaching on a Sunday. A guy came up to me and said, could I shake your hand and just thank you for the spiritual influence you've had on my life? I said, well, that's real nice, but who are you? He said, let me tell you my story. He said, a few years ago, I lost my job. And I didn't have any money, no money in the bank. I thought I was going to lose my house, my car, everything. I didn't know what to do. I was panic-stricken. So I called a friend of mine that runs a newspaper. I said, you got any odd jobs I could do to earn some money? And he said, well, do you know how to tile floors? I said, yeah, I've tiled floors. I can do that. He said, we've got some tile that needs to be installed and repaired. If you can do that, I'll give you a paycheck for a while. I said, great. So he said, I came to work at the newspaper, and he said, one day, not long before Easter, I was in the business office of the newspaper on my hands and knees behind the desk on the floor working on some tile. And you came in there, and I don't even think you knew I was there because you started talking to this guy. And you start talking about Jesus, and you start talking about the evidence for the resurrection, and you start inviting him to church, and he was shutting you down. But I'm on my hands and knees on the floor, and my heart's beating fast, and I'm thinking, I need God. I need to go to church. So he said, as soon as you left, I picked up the phone, I called my wife, I said, we're going to church this Easter. She said, what? I said, no, we are. He said, we came to your church that Easter, and I came to faith, my wife came to faith, and our teenage son came to faith. And I just wanted to thank you. And I thought, talk about an unexpected adventure. This is a new form of evangelism, ricochet evangelism. You share your faith, it bounces off a hard heart. You don't know where it's going to go. Friends, we don't want to miss this unexpected adventure of the Christian life. So let's pray and let's ask God to use us in the lives of people we encounter who don't know him. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this group of people. What a great group of folks. And we do pray by your Spirit, you would lead us and guide us into these unexpected adventures. Give us the courage to share a simple word about Jesus, to share our story, to answer some questions, to volunteer to help someone find answers. Help us to create some safe places in our world where non-believing friends can come and investigate who you are. We thank you for this group. I just picture it like a light on a hill. These counselors all over the country, in their churches, in their neighborhoods, in their practices, in their homes, making a difference for you. We thank you for them. Pray you would encourage them and use them in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, everyone. Thank you.
Let's thank Lee Strobel.